over my husband,
George.
George is a good boy. You know that. My son has always gone out of his way to give others a hand. Now it's him who needs the help.
Help my big brother, George. He's done so much for all of us. More for me than I
remember. I remember a time too silly after work in Oscar's set.
Mom needs more like George Bailey when he thinks about himself. I wouldn't have a roof over my head if it
wasn't for him. I would have given up long ago. All I think about is myself. I must have taken the last cent he had.
He had no sense of business, that George Bailey. Just like his father. None of the Baileys were ever businessmen. It's his own fault if he wasn't prepared for times like
these. Times like these, I can't help but think it's my fault. Help him, Father. It's me who's putting him through all this.
Something's the matter with Daddy.
Should we pray for him, Mommy?
Yes, Zuzu. Pray. Pray very hard.
You sent for me, sir?
Yes, Clarence. A man down on Earth needs our help.
Splendid. Is he sick?
No, worse. He's discouraged. At exactly 10:45 p.m. tonight, Earth time, that man will seriously be thinking of throwing away God's greatest gift.
Oh dear, you mean his life? That means I've only got an hour to dress. What are they wearing nowadays?
You will spend that hour getting acquainted with George Bailey.
Sir, if I were to accomplish this mission, do you think I could possibly get my wings? I've been waiting over 200 years now. People are starting to talk.
What's that book?
The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. I was reading it before you sent for me.
Oh, fine book. Excellent. Well, you do a good job with George Bailey. We'll see about your wings.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Now, if you're going to help George, you'll want to know a little something about him. Look, see that town?
Why, yes. A group of young boys sledding down a snow-covered hill onto the ice. This is amazing.
Yippee!
Who's that?
That's your problem. George Bailey.
A boy?
That's him when he was 12, back in 1919. Something happens here that you'll have to remember later on.
And here comes the big scare baby, my kid brother, Harry Bailey.
I'm not scared!
Mom, get out of here, Harry!
Yippee! Ah! Ow! Ow!
Oh dear!
Ah!
Harry's falling through the ice!
Oh! Help me, Harry! Ow! Make a chain, gang! A chain! Ow!
So, Harry fell through the ice, but George saved him?
That's right, Clarence. And ever since, George has had a bad ear. All that icy water. You understand?
Bad ear. Yes, sir.
George Bailey.
You're late.
Yes, sir.
Hello, George. Mom. Hello, Violet.
2 cents worth of shoelaces, Violet?
Mary was here first.
I'm still thinking.
Shoelaces?
Please, Georgie. I like him.
You like every boy.
What's wrong with that?
Here we are.
Bye, Georgie. See you later, Mary.
Make up your mind yet, Mary?
I'll take chocolate.
With coconuts?
I don't like coconuts.
You don't like coconuts? Say, Brainless, don't you know where coconuts come from? Looky here. From Tahiti. The Fiji Islands. The Coral Sea.
What's that you got there? A new magazine? I never saw it before.
Of course you never. Only us explorers get it. I've been nominated for membership in the National Geographic Society. Let me get your ice cream.
Is this the ear you can't hear on? George Bailey, I'll love you till the day I die.
I'm going out exploring someday. You watch. I'm going to have a couple of harems and maybe 3 or 4 wives. Wait and see.
George! George!
Yes, sir?
You're not paid to be a canary.
Yes, sir.
Bye, George.
See you later, Mary.
What's that piece of paper George just picked up?
It's a telegram from Mr. Gower. He found out this morning that his son died of tuberculosis.
Oh, awful.
Yes, and he spent the entire afternoon drowning his grief in whiskey.
Mr. Coward, do you want something? Anything?
No.
Anything I can do back here?
No.
Oh, I'll get him, sir. What's in this bottle, Mr. Gower?
Never mind that. Take those capsules and this plants.
Yes, sir. They have the diphtheria over there, haven't they? Is it a charge, sir?
Yes, charge.
Mr. Gower, I think—
I'll get going!
Yes, sir. Mr. Gower,
what is it?
Mr. Gower, you— that bottle you used, you put something wrong in those capsules.
Who do you think you're talking to?
You're hurting my short ears.
You're what I said. Get out of here!
Mr. Gower, you don't know what you're doing. You put something wrong in these capsules. I know you're unhappy. You got that telegram and you're upset. But look, Mr. Gower, look. The bottle you used to make up the capsules, it's poison.
Poison!
Don't hurt my short ear again.
Poison? Oh, George. George.
All I wanted to do was make sure. I won't tell anyone. I know what you're feeling. I won't ever tell a soul. Hope to die, I won't.
George, George.
Did he ever tell anyone about those pills?
Not a soul.
Did he ever marry the girl? Did he ever go exploring?
We'll get there soon enough, Clarence. When George grew up, he wanted to go to college, but there just wasn't the money. So he worked 4 years at the Building and Loan Association.
Building and Loan Association.
George's father worked in the building and loan business, along with George's Uncle Billy.
George, what's the combination to the safe?
We wrote it down so you wouldn't forget it.
That's right. Where?
Your wallet, Uncle Billy.
Thanks.
Oh, well, just forgetful is all.
Who's that?
That's Henry F. Potter, the richest and meanest man in all the county.
Peter, Potter's here.
Mr. Bailey, Mr. Bailey, Mr. Bailey, there's nothing quite so wholesome as running a family business. Now, you know what I'm here for. I'm on a tight schedule. Family to evict at 3.
All right then, Mr. Potter. Here's the thing. I just need a little more time. Just 30 short days. I'll dig up that $5,000 somehow.
Have you put any real pressure on those people of yours to pay back their mortgages?
Times are hard, Mr. Potter. A lot of people are out of work.
Then foreclose.
I can't do that. These families have children.
They're not my children.
They're somebody's children, Mr. Potter.
Are you running a business or a charity war? Well, not with my money.
Mr. Potter, what makes you such a hard-skulled character? You have no family, no children. You can't even begin to spend all the money you've got.
So I suppose I should leave it to miserable failures like you and that idiot brother of yours to spend for me.
He's not a failure. You can't say that about my father.
George.
You're not. You're the biggest man in town.
Wait, I'll talk to you tonight.
Don't let him say that to you, Pop.
Tonight.
What kind of business are you running here? Good God, man.
Saving enough money to steam through the university. That summer, though, he was going to Europe. George got a job on a cattle boat and was ready to do a little traveling before college. Old man Gower surprised him with the gift of a great big suitcase. On his way home from the store, he ran into his friends, Ernie the cab driver and Ernie the cop.
Hey, Ernie.
Oh, hi, George.
Hi, Bert.
Hey, George. What's a suitcase for?
I'm a rich tourist today. How about driving me home in style?
Sure thing, Your Highness. Hop in the cab. For the carriage trade, it's on my hat.
Good afternoon, Mr. Bailey. Looks like you're ready to get out of here.
Hello, Violet. Yeah, you look good. That's some dress you got on there.
Oh, this old thing? Why, I only wear this and I don't care how I look. See you later.
How would you like?
Yeah.
Want to come along, girl? We'll show you the town.
No, thanks. I think I'll go home and see what the wife's doing.
Family man.
Boy, oh boy, oh boy. It's hard to realize it's finally the last night in the old family boarding house.
We're sure gonna miss you, George.
I'm gonna miss you too, Pop. Say, what's wrong? You look tired.
Oh, I had another tussle with old Henry today.
Oh.
I thought when we put him on the board of directors, he'd ease up on us.
I wonder what's eating that old money-grubbing buzzard anyway.
Oh, he's a sick man. Frustrated and sick. Sick in his mind, sick in his soul. If he has one. Hates anybody who has anything he can't have. Hates us mostly, I guess.
Hey, George, can I borrow tuxedo studs?
Yeah, help yourself, Harry.
Well, where are they? In your suitcase?
I'm not taking a tuxedo on a cattle boat, you know.
Where'd you get such a fine piece of luggage anyway?
Ah, from Mr. Gower. It was a going-away present. And one of these days, you're gonna see this old bag covered with travel labels. Italy, Baghdad.
Hey, I've my idea. Why don't you come to the dance tonight?
What? And be bored to death?
Couldn't ask for a better one. Lots of pretty girls. Hey, I've got Harry.
I wish we could send Harry to call George.
You've got that all figured out. See, Harry will take my job at the building and loan, work there for years, then he'll go.
He's pretty young for that job.
No younger than I was.
You were born older, George. I suppose you've decided what you're gonna do. I need to get out of college.
Yeah. Well, you know, what I've always talked about doing. Building things. Design new buildings. Plan modern cities.
Still after that first million before you're 30?
I'll settle for about half of that in cash.
It's just a thought, but you wouldn't consider coming back to the building and loaning. I know it's early to talk about.
I'm sorry. I couldn't face spending the rest of my life being cooped up in that shabby little office. I'm sorry, Pop. I didn't mean that last remark. It's just this business of nickels and dimes and trying to save 3 cents on the length of a pipe. I'd go crazy. I want to do something big, something important.
You know, George, I feel that in a small way, we are doing something important. Satisfying a fundamental urge. It's not too much for a man to have his own walls and roof and fireplace. And we're helping him get those things in our shabby little office.
I know, Dad. I wish I felt the same, but I've been hoarding pennies like a miser in order to get away, and listen, most of my friends have already finished college. I just feel like if I don't get away, I'd bust.
Yes. Yes, you're right, boy. This town's no place to live if you're not willing to call the potter. You get yourself an education, then get out of here.
I'm glad you see what I'm talking about. Say, I think I'm gonna go out on Old Main Street, last night in town at all.
Have a good time, son.
Not a thing.
Are you game, Vi? What do you say we make a night of it?
I'd love it, Georgie. What will we do?
First, let's go out in the fields, take off our shoes, and walk through the grass.
Huh?
Then, we can go up to Stuart Lake and swim. It's beautiful up there in the moonlight. And then we can climb out Bedford and smell the pines and watch the sunrise against the peaks. And we'll stay up there the whole night. And everybody will be talking and there will be a terrific scandal.
George, have you gone crazy? Walk in the grass on my bare feet? Why, it's 10 miles up to Mount Bedford. You think just because you... Ugh.
All right. Just forget about the whole thing then.
Forget about what, George?
Nothing, Sam.
You remember Mary, don't you?
Hi, George.
Hi, Mary.
Say, you wouldn't mind taking Mary home, would you, George?
Of course not. Is that all right with you, Mary?
Fine by me.
Great, thanks.
George walked Mary home. Is that important, Joseph?
I'd say so, because even though Mary lived only 4 blocks away, it took them 2 hours to get there.
Buffalo gals, won't you come out tonight? Won't you come out tonight? Won't you come out tonight? Buffalo gals, won't you come out tonight?
And dance
by the light of the moon.
Hot dog, just like an organ, gee whiz.
Beautiful!
You know something, Mary? If it weren't just me talking, I'd say you were the prettiest girl in town.
Well, why don't you say it?
I don't know. Maybe I will. How old are you anyway?
18.
18?
Too young or too old?
No, just right. Your age suits you. Oh, hey, look where we are.
Oh, the old Granville house.
Yeah, I've got to throw a rock.
Oh, no, don't. I love that old house.
Well, no, don't you know about old houses? You make a wish, and then you throw a rock.
But George, it's such a lovely old place. I wish I lived there.
In there? I wouldn't live in there if I was a ghost. Now watch, watch this. How about it, huh? Pretty good shot, huh? Broken window, huh?
What'd you wish for, George?
Oh, not just one wish, Mary, a whole hatful. Mary, I'm shaking the dust of this crummy little town off my feet, and I'm gonna go see the world. Italy, Greece, the Parthenon, the Colosseum. Then I'm gonna go to college and see what they know. But then I'm gonna build things, Mary. I'm gonna build skyscrapers 100 stories high. I'm gonna build bridges 1 mile long. I'm gonna build airfields that stretch on. Wait, are you gonna throw a rock too? Yeah, that's pretty good. What'd you wish for, Mary?
Oh no, if I tell you, it might not come true.
Oh, come on now, Mary. What'd you wish for? You want the moon? All you've gotta do is say the word.
Okay, the moon. I'll take it. Then what?
Then what? Then I can throw a lasso around it and pull it down. You could swallow it and it would dissolve, see? And the moonbeams would shoot out of your fingers and toes and the ends of your hair. Am I talking too much?
Yes! Why don't you get here instead of talking to them?
Who's there?
Old man Collins sitting on his front porch.
Ah, he's wasting on the wrong
people. Hey, you get back here, you old geezer. I'll show you kissing that'll put hair back on your head.
George!
Crazy
George.
Old Uncle, what's wrong?
George, get in the car quick. Your father's had a stroke.
I'm sorry, Mary. I've got to go.
Assets and liabilities over to the receiver.
That's outrageous!
It's too soon after Peter Bailey's death to discuss chloroforming the building and loan. It was his faith and devotion that are responsible for this organization.
I'll go further than that. I'll say that to the public, Peter Bailey was the building and loan.
That's fine coming from you, Potter, considering you probably drove him to his grave.
Peter Bailey was not a businessman. That's what killed him. I don't mean to be disrespect to him. God rest his soul. He was a man of high ideals, so-called. But ideals without common sense can ruin this town. And what'll that get us? A discontented, lazy rabble instead of a thrifty working class. And all because a few starry-eyed dreamers like Peter Bailey stir them up and fill their heads with a lot of impossible hooey. Now I say—
Now hold on just a minute. Wait a second, Mr. Potting. You're right when you say my father wasn't a businessman. I know that. Why he ever started this cheap, penny-ante building and loan, I'll never know. But neither you nor anybody else has any right to say anything about his character. Why, In the 25 years since he and Uncle Billy started this thing, he never once thought of himself. Isn't that right, Billy?
You got that right.
He didn't save enough money to send Harry to college, let alone me. But he did help a few people get out of your slums, Mr. Potter. What's wrong with that? I mean, here, you're all businessmen here. Doesn't that make them better citizens? Doesn't that make them better customers? What'd you say a minute ago? That they had to wait and save their money before they even ought to think of buying a decent home? Wait? Wait for what? Until their children grow up and leave them? Until they're so old and broken down that they... Do you know how long it takes a working man to save $5,000, Mr. Potter? Just remember this. This rabble you're talking about? They do most of the working and the paying and the living and the dying in this community. Well, is it too much to have them work, pay, live, die in a couple of decent rooms and a bath? Anyway, my father didn't think so. People were human beings to him. But to you, a warped, frustrated old man, they're cattle. Well, in my book, he died a much richer man than you'll ever be.
I don't care about your book. I'm talking about the building and loan.
I know exactly what you're talking about. You're talking about something you can't get your hands on, and it's galling you. That's what you're talking about. Anyway, I've said too much here. You're the board. Just remember this one more thing, though. This town needs this measly one horse institution, if only to have some place where people can go without crawling to Potter.
Sentimental hogwash! I want my motion!
They're just coming out of the board meeting. I'll have to call you back. What happened, George? All we heard was a bunch of yelling.
Boy, oh boy, Matilda, you should have heard, George.
Yeah, the voting is down in there.
Come on, George, get out of here. You already missed your boat trip. You wanted his college, too? Don't worry about the board. They're putting us out of business. So what? I can get another job. I'm only 55.
You're 58. George! George! They voted Potter down! We're still in business!
Whoopee! We're still in business! We're still in business!
But George, there's one condition. They've appointed you to take your father's place.
Appoint me? No, that's not right. I'm going to college. Uncle Billy here, he's your man.
You can keep him on, that's all right.
All right, now let's get this thing straight right now. I'm leaving. I'm going to school. This is my last chance.
But George, you've got to take it. They'll vote with Potter otherwise.
Served, lunch is served, and dinner is served.
No. Anchor chains, plane motors, and train whistles. Oh, here's the professor now.
Poor visit, George Geographic Explorer Bailey. Uncle Billy, you haven't changed a bit.
Nobody ever changes around here, you know that.
Boy, am I glad to see you.
Say, where's Mother?
She's back home cooking the fatty calves. Come on, let's go.
Wait. This is Ruth Dakin.
Ruth Dakin Bailey, if you don't mind.
Huh? Well, I wired you as a prize. Meet the wife.
Well, what do you know? Wife.
Congratulations! Harry, why didn't you tell somebody? What's a pretty girl like you doing marrying this two-headed brother of mine?
Well, I'll tell you. He's purely mercenary. My father offered him a job.
Oh, he gets you and the job. Well, Harry's cup runneth over. Come on, Ruth. Let's start ahead and leave the bags with the fellas.
All right.
George, about that job, Ruth spoke out of turn. I never said I would take it. We've been holding down the bag here for 4 years, and well, I won't let you down.
It's all right, Harry. It's all right.
That night, the homecoming for Harry became his wedding party. Uncle Billy familiarized himself with the spirit.
Boy, oh boy, I feel so good. I could spit in Potter's eye. I think I will. Maybe I should just go home. Maybe you could point me in the right direction.
Yeah, just right down there.
That way, huh? Okay, old Billy, old pal. See you later. I'm all right. I'm all right.
George?
Yeah, I'm out here on the porch, Mother. Just thought I'd get some air.
Well, how do you like the new sister-in-law?
She's swell.
Looks like she'll keep Harry on his toes.
Keep him out of Bedford Falls, anyway.
George, did you hear that Mary Hatch is back from school?
Yeah.
Nice girl, Mary. Oh, stop grumbling. Give me one good reason you shouldn't call on Mary.
Well, Sam Wainwright. Sam's crazy about her.
Well, she's not crazy about him.
Oh, come on now. How do you know that? Did she discuss it with you?
Besides, Sam is away in New York, and you're here in Bedford Falls.
All's fair in love and war.
I don't know about war.
All right, Mother. I think I'll go out. I'll find the girl, and I'll do a little passionate necking.
George!
Bye, Mrs. Bailey. By the way, do you want any books at the library?
The library, George! You go and visit Mary, you hear?
Your mother just phoned and said you're on your way over to pay me a visit.
My mother called you? Well, how did she know?
Well...
I didn't tell anybody I was coming here. I just went for a walk. When'd you get back?
Tuesday. Would you like to come in?
All right. Since I'm here. Where'd you get that dress?
Do you like it?
It's all right. I thought you'd stay in New York with Sam and... Francie and the rest of them.
Oh, I worked there a couple of vacations, but I don't know. I guess I was homesick.
Homesick? For Bedford Falls?
Yes, my family and, everything. Would you like to sit down?
All right. I still don't get it, though. I didn't tell anybody I was coming here.
Would you rather leave?
No. I don't want to be rude.
It was nice about Harry and Ruth, wasn't it?
Who? Oh, what? Yeah, them.
Don't you like her?
Well, of course I like her. She's a peach.
Oh, it's just marriage in general you're not enthusiastic about.
No, marriage is fine for Harry and Sam Wainwright and yourself.
Mary? Mary, who's out there with you?
It's George Bailey, Mother.
George Bailey? What does he want?
I don't know. What do you want, George?
Me? Not a thing. I just came in to get warm.
He's making violent love to me, Mother.
You tell him to go right back home and don't you leave the house. Sam Wainwright promised to call from New York tonight, didn't he?
Your mother didn't... I didn't come here for... to...
What did you come here for?
Me? I don't know. You tell me. You're the one who's supposed to have all the answers here. Why don't you tell me?
Why don't you go home?
That's where I'm going. I don't know why I came here in the first place.
Mary! The telephone! It's Sam!
I'll get it. Hee-haw. Hello, Sam. How are you?
Oh, great. Gee, it's good to hear your voice again.
Oh, well, that's awfully sweet of you, Sam. Now, there's an old friend of yours here, George Bailey.
You mean old Mossback George?
Yes, old Mossback George.
Hee-haw! Put him on!
George, Sam wants to speak to you.
He doesn't want to speak to George, you idiot!
He does so. He asked for him. George?
Hello?
Hey, some fine pal you are. What are you trying to do? Steal my girl or something?
Nobody's trying to steal your girl.
No, wait. I want to talk to the both of you. Tell Mary to get on the extension.
Mother's on the extension.
I'm not!
Here, we can both hear you. George, lean your head a little bit closer.
Okay.
I have a big deal coming up that's going to make us all rich. George, do you remember that night at Martini's bar when you were telling me how to make plastics out of soybeans?
Yeah, soybeans.
Well, my father's checked into it, see? And he's gonna build a huge factory here in Rochester. How do you like the sound of that?
Rochester? Well, why Rochester?
Well, why not? Can you name anything better?
Well, why not right here in Bedford Falls? That old tool and machinery works? You tell your father he can get that thing for a song. And all the labor he wants too. But half the town went out of business when that thing shut down.
That's so? Well, I'll tell him. Hey, that sounds great. Oh, baby, I knew you'd come through. Now, George, here's the point. I may have a job for you, unless you're still married to that old broken-down building and loan. Oh, Mary?
I'm here.
You let that boy know I'm giving him the chance of a lifetime, you hear?
He says it's the chance of a lifetime.
Give me that phone. Now, you listen to me. I don't want any job, and I don't want any plastics. And I don't want to get married to anyone ever. Do you understand me? I want to do what I want to do, and you're not... Mary. Oh, Mary, I love you.
George, I love you too.
Shoot the works, Ernie.
A whole week in New York, a whole week in the marina. The highest hotels, the hottest music, the richest caviar, the oldest champagne, and the prettiest wife.
Here's the kitty, Ernie. $2,000. I feel like a bootlegger's wife.
So you're finally getting out of Bedford Falls, huh? And then what?
Then what, honey?
After that, who cares?
That's it, Mrs. Bailey.
Hey, George, there's something funny going on over there. Look, at the bank. It looks like a run.
George, please, let's go straight to the station. Let's not stop.
No, Mary, I better see what this is.
George!
I'll be right back.
Please! George!
We lose our license.
Bailey Brothers building in.
Give me George.
George, it's Potter.
George, there's a rumor going around town that you closed your doors. Is that true?
No, it isn't.
Do you need any police? I know mobs can get pretty ugly sometimes.
We're fine.
We'll see. George, I'm going all out to help you in this crisis. I just guaranteed the bank sufficient funds to meet their needs. They'll close for a week and then reopen. I may lose a fortune on this, but I'm willing to guarantee your people too. Just have them come down here with their shares, and I'll pay them 50 cents on the dollar.
Oh, you don't miss a trick, do you, Potter? Well, you're gonna miss this one.
If you close your doors before 6 p.m., you'll never reopen!
You just took the bank, Billy. Open the doors. You gotta let them in. Everybody, listen to me, please. Just remember, this thing isn't as black as it all appears. I just got off the phone with old Henry Potter, and he's guaranteed us cash payments at the bank.
What about our money, George? Where's our money?
Now, here's the thing. You're thinking of this place all wrong. The money's not here.
What do you mean the money's not here?
Listen to me. It's in people's houses. In the Kennedy house, and the McLaren house, and even your house.
Now what are you gonna do, just foreclose on them?
I got $242 in here, and $242 isn't gonna break anyway.
Oh, come on, Charlie, you'll get your money in 60 days.
60 days?
That's what you agreed to when you bought your shares.
I got my money. Old man Potter's taking over the bank. He'll give me 50 cents on every dollar.
50 cents on every dollar?
No, no, everybody, listen to me. Listen to me, please, I'm begging you. Mr. Potter's after us because he wants to own you and keep you living in his shacks and paying the kind of rent that he decides to charge. He's got the banks, he's got the bus line, he's got the department stores, and now he's after us. Now, we can get through this, but we've got to believe in each other. We've got to have faith in each other.
My husband's out of work. We need money.
I got doctor bills to pay.
Can't feed my kids with faith.
How much do you need? We still got some money. We got $2,000 from the wedding.
Hey, Mary! All right, I've got $2,000 right here. All right, Charlie. Now, how much do you need?
$242.
Oh, come on, Charlie. Just enough to get you by?
I'll take $242.
All right, Uncle Billy, give me this $242. Okay. Now, Ed, how much do you need? Just enough to get you by.
$20, I suppose.
$20? Now we're talking. All right, now, you, Mrs. Thompson, how much do you need?
But, George, it's your own money.
Never mind that. How much?
$17.50.
Of course! Bless your heart, of course! Alright, pay it back when you can now. Pay it back when you can. Okay. Alright, who's next?
Look at the clock, look!
5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3, 2, 1, 6 o'clock! We made it and we've got $2 left!
Bailey Brothers building a... Just a second. George, there's a call for you.
Look, will you get my wife on the phone? She's probably over at her mother's.
Mrs. Bailey's on the phone.
I don't want Mrs. Bailey. I want my wife. Wait a minute. Mrs. Bailey. Yeah, that is my wife. Hello? Listen, dear, I'm sorry. Come home? What home? 320 Sycamore? Huh? The Waldorf Hotel.
You always have my imagination. Sometimes it borders on fantasy. And sometimes I find visions flash through my mind. Close to reality.
That doesn't look like the Waldorf.
Oh no. Number 320 Sycamore was the old grandpa house. Georgia made new rocks and made wishes. Mary had prepared the house, including a turkey dinner, romantic decorations, and even a marriage bed.
Welcome home, Mr. Bailey.
We'll all be.
Remember the night you broke the windows in this old place? This is what I wish for.
Darling. You're wonderful.
Yes, sir. That's where they spent their honeymoon. That's where they started their lives together. Mary made the leaky old house a home, while George told her at the building and loan office, providing housing for people like Giuseppe Martini.
Hey, Martini, you're renting a new place?
Rent! Ha! You hear that, Mr. Bailey? I own my own house. Me, Giuseppe Martini. I own this house. No more we live like a pig in a potter's field.
Here's something for you and your family, Mr. Martini. George and I bring something for all the new owners.
For the Martinis? Maria, come quick. Our first housewarming gifts.
Bread. That your house may never know hunger. Salt. The life may always have flavor.
And wine. That prosperity may reign forever. Enter the Martini Castle.
Sit down, George, sit down. Have a cigar.
Thank you, sir. Light a cigar, Mr. Potter.
You like them? I'll send you a box.
Mr. Potter, I suppose I'll find out sooner or later, but just what exactly did you want to talk to me about?
Now that's what I like so much about you, George. George, I'm an old man and most people hate me. But I don't like them either, so it evens out. You know that I run practically everything in this town, except the building and loan. You also know that for a number of years, I've been trying to get control of it, or kill it, but I haven't been able to. You've stopped me, and that takes some doing. Take during the Depression, for instance. You and I were the only ones that kept our heads. You saved the building and loan, and I saved the rest.
Yes, well, most people say you stole all the rest.
The envious ones say that, George. The suckers. Now let's look at it from your point of view. Young man, 27, 28, married, making, say, 40 a week?
45.
45.
45.
If you were some ordinary yokel, I would say you were doing fine. But George Bailey
is intelligent, ambitious. He hates the building and loan almost as much as I do. He's been dying to get out of this town ever since he was born. A young man. The smartest one of the crowd, mind you, has to sit by and watch his friends go places. All because he's trapped. Trapped into frittering his life away, playing nursemaid to a bunch of garlic eaters. Now, do I paint the correct picture, or do I exaggerate, George?
What's your point, Mr. Potter?
My point is, George, you're the only man in town who's licked me. I want to hire you. I'll start you at $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
You wouldn't mind that, would you, George?
You wouldn't mind living in the nicest house in town, buying your wife a lot of fine clothes, a couple of trips to New York a year, maybe even once in a while to Europe? You wouldn't mind that.
Would I? You're not talking to somebody else around here, are you? I'm George Bailey from the building and loan, remember?
Yes. George Bailey, whose ship has just come in, provided he has the brains enough to climb aboard.
But what about the building and loan?
Confound it, man! I'm offering you $20,000 a year for 3 years. Is it a deal or isn't it?
Mr. Potter, I know I ought to jump at the chance, but is there any chance you might give me 24 hours just to think about it?
Sure, sure. You go home and talk to your wife. In the meantime, I'll have the papers drawn up, and soon you'll be managing my affairs.
Your affairs? No. No. No, 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 no. The answer's no, doggone it. You sit here and you spin your little webs and you think the whole world revolves around you and your money. Well, it doesn't, Mr. Potter. You know, I'd say in the whole vast configuration of things, you're nothing but a scurvy little spider. Sam Wainwright, anybody else in town.
I didn't want to marry anybody else in town, George. I want my baby to look like you.
I didn't even give you a proper honeymoon.
Your what?
My baby.
You mean Mary. You're on the nest?
George Bailey, lasso stork.
Baby, a boy.
Well, you don't say.
Then she had a girl.
Well, what do you know?
Night after night, George came a little home late from the office. Things were really going hard. Potter was really bearing down hard. Then came the war. Mary had another baby, but still had time to run the USO. Old Man Gower and Uncle Billy sold war bonds. Violet entertained the troops. Bert the Cobb was wounded in North Africa, got the Silver Star. Ernie the cab driver parachuted into France. And Harry Bailey topped them all. A Navy flyer, he shot down 15 planes, two of them as they were about to crash into a transport full of soldiers.
Yes, but George, what about George?
George? Poor F on account of his ear. George fought the Battle of Bedford Falls. Air raid warden, paper drives, scrap drive, and overdrives. On VE Day, he wept and prayed. VJ Day, he wept and prayed again.
We're getting pretty close to the day, aren't we, sir?
That's right, Clarence. You now know almost everything you need to know about George Bailey, except what finds him down here at this moment, wanting to die.
Well, sir, well?
Well, today's the day before Christmas. And Pot and Billy is at the bank to make a deposit, and he ran into Old Man Potter.
Well, 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 Mr. Henry F. Potter. Come to the bank to deposit some more loot, huh?
Sure, you old fool.
How do you like the headline in the paper, Mr. Potter? Harry Bailey wins the Congressional Medal of Honor. Just can't keep those Bailey boys down, can you?
Give me that paper.
All right. Sorry, can't chat, you old thief. Gotta make a deposit.
Good morning, Mr. Bailey.
Good morning, Horace. Here you are. Bank book, deposit slip, and a very Merry Christmas to you.
Say, you want to make a deposit, sir?
Well, certainly.
Well, it's customary to bring the money with you.
Where is it? Where did I put that money?
What's wrong with starting a new life right here in Bedford Falls?
Well, I'll be. Never thought I'd hear that from you, George Bailey. I thought you hated this place.
I did, but this town has a charm of its own.
You could give tours, maybe.
I'm just thinking of you, Violet. Manhattan's a big place to take on your own.
I've made a decision. There's a midnight train tonight, and I plan to be on it.
It takes a lot of courage to move away and go to a new place all by yourself. Here. Here's some dough.
No, George, don't.
What do you want to do? Hawk your furs in that hat? You want to walk all the way to New York? You know they charge for meals and rent up there just the same as they do in Bedford Falls.
Yeah, sure.
It's a loan. That's my business, building and loan. Besides, it'll get a job. Good luck to you.
I'm glad I know you, George Bailey.
Say hi to New York for me.
Merry Christmas, George.
George! George!
Uncle, what's going on? The bank examiner's in town today.
Today?
Yeah, he wants the accounts payable. What's wrong?
I don't know, George. I was on my way to deposit the money.
Uncle Billy, what happened to it?
When I got there, I lost it.
$8,000, Uncle Billy. The bank examiner's in town today, and it's not our money. It belongs to the depositors.
Oh, I don't know what happened, George.
Well, the first place you look is always your coat pocket. I told you to put it there when you left.
I'm no good to you. I'm no good.
Let's go, then. We've got to retrace our steps. We'll leave no stone unturned.
As George and Uncle Billy went looking for the deposit, Potter had to be the state bank examiner, a Miss Sadie Vance.
The whole town is turned upside down with the Bailey boys' homecoming. Congressional medal and all.
I guess they do things like that.
May I look at your paper?
Go ahead.
This is a deposit from Bailey.
That old fool Billy Bailey gave me that newspaper.
Well, you're going to deposit it for him, right?
To think he made such a mistake. How much is it?
There's $8,000 here.
What a Christmas present. And he doesn't even know it.
Just a minute here, Potter. I know you've been giving the Baileys a hard time, far back as I can remember. Why?
You're just a state examiner. I don't have to answer your questions.
Yes, I am, but I'm unimpressed by you buying off everyone in town. Oh, that's it. You could never buy the Baileys.
What?
You heard what I said. The Baileys have always stood for something you have always wanted and are so jealous of. They're honest.
You're fired!
You can't fire me. And once more, I'm not going to turn my back. This is stealing from the Baileys. Something like this could certainly cause them to fold.
Yes. And after 25 years. Finders keepers, you know that. Besides, there's no judge in the county that would find me guilty.
We all know why.
How's your family, Sadie?
My family?
I know how little state positions pay. How does a little Christmas bonus sound?
I want no part of this.
That's not what I heard.
What are you insinuating?
I will not be turned down.
What do you want me to do?
I want you to pay the Baileys a little surprise visit. You'll see the records, they'll be short. You know the rest. Then, finally, the Bailey boys will be where they belong. Down for good.
I know just what to do.
And did you put the money in your pocket?
Yeah, maybe.
Uncle Billy, we gotta find that money. Are there any secret hiding places in the house?
I've looked all over the house. Even in rooms have been locked since I lost your Aunt Laura.
Listen to me, think!
I can't think anymore, George, it hurts.
Listen here, you stupid, silly old fool. Do you realize what this means? This means bankruptcy and scandal. And prison. One of us is going to jail.
Well, it's not gonna be me!
Is it a sore throat?
Just a teensy temperature.
Was the doctor here?
I called him right away.
Oh, gosh. It's this old house. It's a wonder we don't all have pneumonia. Strapped to a little barn. Might as well be living in a refrigerator.
George, what's wrong?
Wrong? Everything's wrong. You call this a happy family? But we have to have all these kids.
Dad, how do you spell frankincense?
I don't know. Ask your mother.
George, where are you going?
Up to see Zuzu. What happened with you?
I want a flower.
Where do you think you're going?
I want to give my flower a drink.
Here, give it to Daddy. I'll give it a drink.
Poor Daddy, some of the petals came off. Paste it.
All right. There. Good as new.
You got a drink.
Now, will you do something for me, please?
What?
Try to get some rest.
I'm not sleepy. I want to look at my flower.
I know, but all you've got to do is fall asleep, and you can dream about it. It'll be a whole garden.
You will?
Telephone!
I'll get it. Hello? Yes, this is Mrs. Bailey. Oh, hello, Mrs. Welsh. Yes, the doctor says she'll be out of time, and she'll be out of bed in time for Christmas dinner.
Is that Zuzu's teacher?
Yes.
Give me that phone. Hello, Mrs. Welsh. This is George Bailey. Say, what do you think sending my kid home like that half-naked?
George?
Is this the sort of thing we pay taxes for? Stupid, silly, careless people like yourself who send our kids home without any clothes on?
Hello? Hello, Mrs. Welsh? I'd like to apologize. She hung up.
I'll hang her up.
I couldn't be sure.
Now, hold on. Hello? Oh, Mr. Waltz. Yeah, that's fine, Mr. Waltz. Gives me a chance to tell you what I really think about your wife.
George!
Will you get out of here and let me handle this? Oh, you will, huh? Well, listen, anytime you think you're man enough, you...
Daddy, how do you spell hallelujah?
What do you think I am? A dictionary? Janie, haven't you learned that stupid tune yet? You keep playing it over and over again. Now just stop it! Stop it, all of you!
George, what are you doing?
Mary... Janie, I'm sorry. You, go on, practice. Go play. And Pete, I owe you an apology, too. What did you want to know again?
Nothing, Daddy.
What's the matter with everybody? Janie, I thought I told you to play. Now go on, practice!
George, why must you torture the children?
Mary, it's not...
Where's Daddy going? Bedford 247, please.
Is something wrong with Daddy?
Yes, Pete.
Shall I pray for him?
Yes, Janie.
Me too.
You too, Tommy. Hello? Uncle Billy?
Why didn't you go to your good friend Sam Wainwright?
I can't get a hold of him. He's in Europe.
What securities would I have, George? What stock or what collateral?
I've got a $15,000 life insurance policy.
What's your equity in it?
$500.
Ha! And you want $8,000. Look at you. You used to be so cocky. You were going to go out and conquer the world. You once called me a warped, frustrated old man. What are you now but a warped, frustrated young man, crawling in here on your hands and knees to ask for help? No securities, no stocks, no bonds. You're worth more dead than alive.
Why don't you go to that rabble you love so much and ask them for help?
Please, Mr. Potter, help me. Help my wife, help my kids.
You know what I'm gonna do for you? As a stockholder of the building and loan, I'm getting the state examiner to get a warrant for your arrest. Manipulation, misappropriation of funds, malfeasance. Go on and run, George. You can't hide in a small town like this. Merry Christmas!
Please, God, show me the way.
Hey, George, need someone to take you home?
Why you drink so much, my friend? You don't feel good? Please, go home, Mr. Bailey.
Bailey? You say Bailey? Which Bailey?
This gentleman is Mr. Bailey. George Bailey.
George Bailey, huh?
And if you talk to my wife like that again, you'll get worse. It's not enough she slaves away teaching your stupid kids how to read and write. You gotta pull her out.
You get out of here, Mr. Welch. You hit my best friend.
Right.
You get out.
All right.
You okay, Mr. Bailey?
Who was that?
Mr. Welch, but no worry, he not come back in this place no more. Your face is bleeding.
I'm all right.
Please don't go, Mr. Bailey.
Leave me
Bailey.
Alone. Leave
please
me alone.
Don't.
George is headed to the bridge now, Clarence. Can you see him?
He looks like he's going to jump.
It's time, Clarence.
Excuse me, have you got the time?
My watch is dead.
Thanks, just the same. Help! Help! I can't swim!
Hold it,
help!
Mr. I'm coming.
What in the same hell are you doing here? This storm's not fit for man nor beast. Come inside. Are you two all right? You guys need a doctor?
No, I'm fine.
I'm all right. This undershirt. I didn't have any time to change into anything stylish. My wife gave this to me on my last birthday. I passed away in it.
Passed away?
Oh, I see Tom Sawyer's drawing out too.
Who?
My book. I came in such a hurry, I brought Tom Sawyer with me. You should read the new novel. You should read the new novel Mark Twain is working on.
How'd you happen to fall in?
Fall in? I didn't fall in. I jumped in. I jumped in to save you.
Jumped in to save me?
Well, I did, didn't I? You didn't go through with it, did you?
Go through with what?
Suicide.
It's against the law to commit suicide around here.
It's against the law where I come from, too.
Where do you come from?
Heaven.
What?
I had to act quickly. That's why I jumped in. I knew if I were drowning, you would try to save me. And you see, you did. And that's how I saved you.
Well, that's very funny.
Your lip's bleeding, George.
Yeah. I got a bust in the jaw in answer to a prayer.
Oh, no, 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 George. I'm the answer to your prayer.
You said George. How do you know my name? Are you a mind reader or something?
Oh, no.
Are you a mind reader?
No.
Who are you then?
Clarence Oddbody. AS2.
Oddbody? AS2? What's that, AS2?
Angel Second Class.
Hey, I'm getting out of here. You may not need a doctor, but I do.
Cheerio, my good man.
Look here, why'd you want to save me?
I told you, I'm your guardian angel.
I wouldn't be a bit surprised.
Ridiculous of you to think of killing yourself for money. $8,000?
Yeah, and things like that. Now, how'd you know that?
I told you, I'm your guardian angel. I know everything about you.
You look about the kind of angel I'd get. Some kind of fallen angel, aren't you? What happened to your wings?
I haven't earned my wings yet. That's why I'm an angel second class.
Oh, I see.
But you can help me earn them by letting me help you.
You don't happen to have 8,000 bucks on you, do you?
Yeah, no. We don't use money in heaven.
Oh, I keep forgetting. Comes in pretty handy down here, bub.
Oh, tut, tut, tut.
I found it out already. I'm worth more dead than I am alive.
Now look, you shouldn't say things like that. I won't get my wings with that attitude. You just don't know all you've done. If it hadn't been
for me... Yeah, if it hadn't been for me, everybody would be a lot better off. My wife, my kids, and my friends. They'd all be better off if I just hadn't been born.
What'd you say?
I said I wish I'd never been born.
George, that's wonderful.
Wonderful?
The idea you just gave me. Well, you've got your wish. You've never been born.
Never been born.
Precisely. No worries. No $8,000 to get. Nothing. You simply don't exist.
Hey, this is your mind. Say something into that ear.
You don't have a bad ear anymore, George. You're not the George Bailey you think you are.
It's not the doggonest thing.
Your lips stop bleeding too, George.
It is. That's so strange. You know what? I know what I need. I need a drink. How about you, Angel? Do you want a drink?
Well, I don't know.
Come on, we'll go as soon as our clothes are dry.
Oh, our clothes are dry.
So they are. It's so strange. Well, never mind that. We'll just stroll right over to Martini's. Oh, excuse me. I'll stroll, you'll fly.
I haven't got my wings, dum-dum.
That's right. Give it a couple of drinks. We'll both fly. There's a place to sit. Sit down. Hey, Nick. Clarence, welcome to the best bar in Bedford Falls.
Bedford Falls? Don't you mean Pottersville?
Pottersville? Hey, where's Martini?
Look, I'm the boss. You want a drink or not?
All right, fine. Double bourbon. Quick, huh?
Okay. What's yours, bub?
I was thinking... Hold on.
Huh?
Heavy on the cinnamon and light on the cloves. Off with you, lad. And lively now.
Look, mister. We serve hard drinks in here for men who want to get drunk fast. We don't need any characters here to give the joint atmosphere.
Look, just give him the same thing I ordered. He doesn't want any trouble.
Two double bourbon.
What about this place? It's all changed.
All of Bedford Falls has changed. You've got your wish, George. There'll be plenty of things you've never seen before. Oh, look, someone just made it.
Made what?
Every time you hear a bell ring, it means that somewhere an angel just got his wings.
Huh?
Don't mind him, Nick. He just never grew up. How old are you anyway?
293 next May.
That does it. Out of your two pixies. Go through the door or through the window.
Hold on, Nick. You can't do this. Where's Martini?
Stop asking about Martini. Well, well, well. Look who crawled out whatever hole he's been hiding in.
Mr. Gower?
Hey, Romy, did I ever tell you to come panhandling around here again?
George, look. Would you buy me a drink, mister? Just one drink.
Binky, throw the rummy out.
No, Nick, isn't that Mr. Gower the druggist?
That rumhead spent 20 years in prison for poisoning some kid. And if you know him, you must be jailbird yourself. Binky, here's two more. Get him out of here.
Got it, Bob.
No. No, don't do this. I know Martini. Come on. Be reasonable.
Here, I'll help you out. The snow is quite cold.
What was wrong with Mr. Gower?
Mr. Gower doesn't know you, George. You see, you weren't there to stop him from putting the poison into that prescription.
What are you? Some kind of hypnotist? Why am I seeing all these strange things here?
Oh, you see, George, because you were never born.
I got nothing. I've got no cards, no insurance, Zuzu spells.
What?
My little girl Zuzu. I told her I'd taste your flower, but I just put the petals in my pocket, but they're gone. They're all gone. Everything's gone.
But don't you see, George? You've been given a great gift. The ability to see what the world would be like if you had never been born.
You're crazy. You're crazy as a bedbug, and you're driving me crazy, too. Now, I'm going home to see my wife and kids, and I'm going there alone.
You know the drill. Hands behind your back, sister.
Keep your hands off me. Why don't you bust somebody else for a change?
Hey, officer, where'd the building and loan move to?
The building and what?
The Bailey building and loan. It used to be just right up there.
They went out of business years ago. Now all that's left is this burlesque house.
Not so fast, Copper. I know Potter.
That's Violet Bick.
Oh, I know. Believe me, I know.
I know that girl.
Who doesn't? Now get out of our way.
Hey, taxi! Hey, Ernie. Ernie, take me home. I'm going off my nut.
Where do you live?
Oh, come on, Ernie. Don't start pulling that stuff with me now. 320 Sycamore. Now hurry. Zuzu's sick.
320 Sycamore, right?
Yeah. Now, Ernie, straighten me out here. I've got some bad liquor in me or something. Now, your name is Ernie Bishop. You live in Bailey Park with your wife and kid. That's right, yeah?
You seen my wife?
Seen your wife? I've been to your house 100 times.
Listen here, bud. What's the idea? I live in a tiny shack in Pottersfield, and my wife ran away 3 years ago and took the kid. I never seen you in my life.
All right, just step on it. Get me home.
Is this the place?
Is this the place? Of course this is the place.
Well, this house ain't been lived in for 20 years.
Mary! Kids, I'm home! Pete! Tommy! Danny! Zuzu, where are you?
They're not here, George. You have no children.
What did you do with them, Clarence? What did you do with my kids?
All right, put your hands up!
What is this?
No fast moves. Get over here, both of you.
Bert, thank heaven you're here. What happened to this house? Where's Mary? Where are my kids?
Watch him, Bert.
Come on. I'm gonna take you down to the stage.
No, it's that man over there. He says he's an angel. He's trying to hypnotize me.
He'll make me use my nightstick.
Bert, I hate to do this, but...
Hey! Oh, George, get back here!
It's me, George. I thought for sure you'd remember me.
George, who? If you're looking for a room, there's no vacancy.
Listen, Mother, please. Something strange is happening to me. I don't know what it is, but I need a place to stay. Please, just let me stay here.
I don't take in strangers.
I'm not a stranger. I know everybody you know. Your brother-in-law, Uncle Billy?
You know him.
Of course I do.
When did you see him last?
Today, at his house.
That's a lie. He's been in the insane asylum ever since he lost his business. And if you ask me, that's where we belong.
I'm here again, George.
My own mother. My own mother didn't even know me.
Strange, isn't it? How one man's life can have such an effect on so many others. And when he isn't around, he leaves a pretty big hole, doesn't he?
Look, I've heard of things like this before. You've got me under some kind of spell or something. Well, I'm gonna break out of it. I know I saw Billy today at his house. I just gotta think. Think. Bailey Park.
There is no Bailey Park if you weren't around to build it.
We'll see.
This is Bailey Park. People live here. Pretty grim.
This is where Bailey Park is supposed to be, but... What's this gravestone doing here? Why's the name Bailey on it?
That wouldn't be yours.
I know my father's name's on here, but why's Harry's name here too?
Harry Bailey fell through the ice and died at the age of 9.
Oh, that's a lie. Harry Bailey went to war. He won the Congressional Medal of Honor. He saved the lives of every man on that transport.
Every man on that transport died because Harry wasn't to save them, because you weren't there to save Harry. Don't you see, George? You really had a wonderful life, and it would be a real waste to throw it all away.
What do I do now, Clarence?
It's your life, George.
Where's Mary?
Mary?
My wife, Mary. What happened to her if I was never born?
I'm not supposed to tell you, George.
Please, just tell me where she is. That's all I need to know to make the decision.
Fine, but you're not gonna like it.
Where is she, Clarence?
She's an old maid.
Where is she?
She's just about to close up the library. There's gotta be an easier way to get my wings.
Is the library closed?
It's Christmas Eve. We can't stay open all night.
Can I ask you something?
I really should be getting home.
What's there to get home to?
Now, it's none of your business, sir. The library's closed. I suggest you try back the 26th.
Mary, I'm sorry.
How do you know my name?
Please, just give me a couple minutes. That's all I need.
I told you, the library's closed.
Please, just 2 minutes. I'll do anything.
All right, you sound desperate. I'll help if I can. What is it?
No. Isn't this town called Bedford Falls?
It used to be, but that was some time ago. I wasn't very old when Potter was elected and took the town, along with its name, for himself.
So you do know a place called Bedford Falls?
I've seen pictures. It seemed like a very nice place. Things have changed, adapted to times. I have to go.
Mary Hatch. You live on Reed Street, a white Victorian. You turn left at the top of the stairs. You lived with your older brother, Marty, and your mother, Edwina.
How do you know all this? What are you, some crazy man? Stop it, I'm leaving!
Mary, please help me. Just let me touch
you. Get your hands off me, I'll call a cop!
The house you wished for, don't you remember?
I told you, I don't know you, let me go! Officer!
I need you, Mary. Help me, Mary.
Get away from me! Help! Help! Police!
Mary, please help me. Where are our kids?
What?
Mary, please. You're my wife.
Ah!
Clarence. Clarence, give me back. Give me back. I don't care what happens to me. Just only give me back to my wife and kids. Please.
Sam Hill, are you talking about George?
George. You call me George. You mean Bert, you know me?
Of course I know you. I've been looking all over for you.
Bert! Look, my leg's bleeding again. Look at the book, I'm out of there.
Hold on. Are you sure you're okay?
Susan's pedals. I'll hold it right here. Bert! I'm alive again. This is incredible. I'm alive again, Bert!
Well, say, I'll drive you home.
We'll do that and turn the siren wide open.
$8,000, I bet, huh?
George, I got a little paper here.
Oh, I bet it's a warrant for my arrest, isn't it? Oh, isn't it wonderful? Merry Christmas! Mary, kids, I'm home!
Merry Christmas, Daddy!
Daddy! Tell me I can eat you up. Where's your mother?
She went looking for you with Uncle Billy. Daddy!
Zuzu, oh, my little ginger snap. How do you feel?
Fine, Daddy. Not a smidge of temperature.
Not a smidge? Hallelujah!
George! Darling!
Mary!
Mommy's home!
Oh, George!
You won't believe what's happened to me.
You won't believe what's happened either. Come on, come inside. They're on their way.
Who's on their way? The police? The FBI? The National Guard? Who cares? I'm alive again!
Well, stand right over there and don't move. Don't move. They're on their way. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. Uncle Billy, everybody, in here, quick!
Merry Christmas!
Isn't it wonderful? Mary did it, George, Mary did it. She told a few people you were in trouble, and they scattered all over town collecting money. They said, if George is in trouble, you can count on me. You've never seen anything like it.
What is this, George, another run on the bank? Merry Christmas.
The last one's here to the right. Mr. Gower, Merry Christmas, step right up.
Mr. Gower?
I made the rounds of my charge accounts.
Violet Vick?
I'm not gonna go, George. I changed my mind.
I would have a roof over my head if it weren't for you, George. Here you go, $242.
I've been saving this money for a divorce, if I ever get a husband.
Just a second. Quiet, everybody, quiet. There's a telegram from London. Mr. Gower cables you need cash. Stop. My office instructed to advance you up to $25,000. Stop. Hee-haw and Merry Christmas, Sam Wainwright.
Glory to the new
world. Oh, George, Harry! Mary, it looks like I got here too late.
Mary, I got him here as quickly as I could. The fool flew all the way up here in a blizzard.
But Harry, what about your fate in Washington?
Oh, I left right in the middle of it as soon as I got your telegram.
How about some wine?
A good idea. A toast to my big brother George, the richest man in town. Hey!
What's this book, George?
Tom Sawyer.
Look, there's an inscription.
George, remember, no man is a failure. Thanks for the week. Love, Clarence.
What's that?
This is a Christmas present from a very dear friend of mine.
Look, Daddy, teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
That's right. Attaboy, Clarence. Attaboy.